Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Right Between the Eyes by William W. Johnstone and J. A. Johnstone. Narrated by J. Rodney Turner. Chapter 1. Buford Morrison pushed back from the table and proclaimed with a wide, satisfied smile, "Now that was a meal worth making a long, hard ride to enjoy." He paused to sweep his one good eye over his table mates and brought it to rest on Bob Hatfield at the head of the table. "And you lucky so-and-so, being married to the prettiest gal in Wyoming and having her be able to cook that good to boot. Doggone if that don't seem like more good fortune than any one man deserves." Bob grinned amiably. "What can I say? I guess clean living and pure thought sometimes pay off in the end." Seated next to Bob, his wife Consuela rolled her eyes. "I don't know about that," she said. Then, turning her dazzling smile on Buford, she added, "But I do know that flattery can be rewarded by another piece of blueberry pie. Are you sure you don't have room for one more, Marshal?"
"Yes, sad to say that's the case," Buford answered. "Not that the desire ain't there, I promise you. But if I eat one more bite, I'm afraid I might blow up and bust." He gestured toward Bucky, Bob's 11-year-old son, seated next to him. "Save it for the boy here. Young lad's always got room for more pie. Ain't that right?"
"Most always," agreed Bucky.
Then, holding his hands to his stomach, he added, "But right at the moment, I'm afraid I'm in the same fix as you. I don't think I can hardly hold another bite."
"The only solution, then," said Consuela, "is to arrange for each of you to have some later on."
"That's easy enough for you, Bucky. There'll be a piece waiting in the pantry."
"For you, Marshal Morrison, I will wrap a slice in waxed paper, and you can take it with you. Since you are spending the night at the jail to keep an eye on your prisoners, you can either have it before you go to bed, or perhaps when you wake up in the morning with some coffee."
"She's a beauty. She can cook, and she thinks good. The complete package," said Buford. "The only thing is, and I say this with all proper gratitude and meaning no offense, we'll gladly take the pie to have later on. As far as having it with a cup of coffee from your jail, though, Bob, there's where I'd have to consider a serious change in plans."
All right, I get your point," said Bob. Buford wagged his head. "I've made coffee out on the trail under the worst conditions you can name. Wind, dust, rain, snow. But even for all of that, I ain't ever made a pot as awful as what you and your deputies regularly brewed down at that jail of yours." "I said I got your point, didn't I? With nobody arguing against you, where's the need to carry on about it?"
Buford was a deputy U.S. Marshal, operating out of Cheyenne headquarters. Pursuing owl hoots of every stripe throughout all of Wyoming, and sometimes farther, he intermittently passed through Rattlesnake Wells. In the course of these stopovers, he'd gotten to know and become friends with Bob, who was the town marshal here. This also meant exposure to the notoriously vile coffee that Bob and his deputies had a knack for making. No matter who took a turn at the brewing or how they altered their technique, the results were equally dismal. These doomed outcomes had created a reputation of sorts, and had even given rise to speculation that the marshal's office, jail, was perhaps built over some ancient Indian burial site that was retaliating with a bizarre curse. Buford referenced this wild speculation now, continuing with a sly smile.
"All I'm saying is that your luck with bad coffee is enough to make a body wonder some about that Indian curse business. I don't normally take stock in that kind of mumbo-jumbo, but whenever I hear an odd creak or a low moan of wind tonight, I expect it'll cross my mind a time or two."
On this occasion, Buford had shown up in Rattlesnake Wells riding escort to a tumbleweed wagon, a sort of mobile prison with barred sides and reinforcements all around. In such a conveyance, prisoners were collected from different points around the territory and hauled back to Cheyenne for further incarceration until a trial was held to decide their final fate. Buford had arrived on this trip around the middle of the day with three prisoners already in custody. He also had a wagon driver, a man named Crispin, a gout victim, so hobbled by the disease that he hardly ventured more than a few feet away from the wagon. Waiting for the federal lawman at the town marshal's office was a telegram out of Cheyenne informing him of two wanted men, Abner and Ulmer Silas, reported to be in the area, working at one of the gold mines in the Prophecy Mountains north of town. It was the Prophecy gold strike that had turned Rattlesnake Wells from a quiet farming and ranching community into a sprawling, often boisterous boomtown, with no sign of the ore petering out anytime soon. This made it an attraction that drew a steady stream of newcomers, every sort from hard-working, hard-luck dreamers looking to strike it rich and turn their lives around, to opportunistic entrepreneurs planning to cash in by supplying goods at inflated prices to take advantage of those with sudden wealth lining their pockets. And in between, the hustlers, schemers, and double dealers out to make a profit by playing every crooked angle there was. It was a steadily turning mix that also served as a good hiding place for men on the dodge from past misdeeds. Men like the Silas brothers, wanted for bank and train robberies and a handful of murders along the way. The telegram awaiting Buford provided an allegedly solid tip on where to find the Silases and instructed him to apprehend them while he was in the area and then bring them back to Cheyenne along with his other prisoners. In order to carry out this assignment, Buford had asked and been granted permission to house his current prisoners in Bob's jail while he went after the Silases. Not only that, Bob had volunteered to side Buford in rounding up the outlaw brothers. The lawmen were set to head out for the high country in pursuit of their quarry first thing in the morning. The supper at Bob's house was a combination of professional courtesy and plain old hospitality. "The offer to spend the night in our spare bedroom still stands," Consuelo reminded Buford, following his remark about the night noises he might encounter at the jail. "You already have your assistant spending the night there, because he doesn't get around well enough to go any farther than necessary." "I appreciate the kind offer, ma'am, I really do," Buford assured her. "But I'm afraid I gotta turn it down. It's sort of a habit of mine to stick pretty close to the prisoners I take into custody until I've got them turned over to the federal lockup in Cheyenne." "It's a habit you ought to be familiar with, Suela," Bob said. "It's the same one I follow whenever we throw troublemakers in the clink and keep them overnight. Either me or one of the deputies bunk on that cot in the storeroom overnight, too, to make sure there's no funny business."
"And I've never understood that either," said Consuela stubbornly, giving a faint headshake that caused her long, glossy black hair to ripple down either side of her lovely face. "Once you have them secure behind bars, why the need to continue watching them so close? To me, it seems overly cautious."
Buford smiled wryly. "Been more than a few lawmen who figured that same way. Once they had some varmint in handcuffs or behind bars, they reckoned they could relax and let down their guard of mind. Not always, but too often to ignore, that turned out to be a mistake. The only good thing to be said afterward in most of those cases was that it was the last mistake they ever made."
"You teach a harsh lesson, Marshal," Consuela conceded when he had finished.
"It's a harsh life I lead, ma'am." Buford's dry smile turned into a lopsided grin. "But such as it is, it's one I'd just as soon keep living for a while. And hard as it might be to believe, there are a few others who I think sort of like having me around, too. Crispin, my wagon driver, for example. He's a good man,
and under different circumstances, I might very well take you up on your offer and leave him looking after those prisoners at the jail on his own tonight. But with his gout giving him the miseries as bad as it is, I don't want to stick him with being the only one to handle that pack of rascals. Knowing I wasn't around and also knowing Crispin Dalen the way he is, it'd be like him to raise a ruckus and keep him hopping the whole time just for low-down orneriness. With me on hand, that ain't apt to happen. Standing 6'4" tall and weighing in at well over 200 pounds, carried on a rugged barrel-chested frame, Buford Morrison wasn't somebody too many men wanted to trifle with. In addition to his intimidating appearance, there was the near-mythical reputation that had taken root about his sheer toughness. Starting with the shootout during which a ricocheting bullet fragment had taken out his left eye. Hardly slowed by the misfortune, Buford had kept on fighting, bloody mucus running down the side of his face, until he'd cut down the last of the desperados who'd been gunning for him and he alone was left standing. After that, he took to wearing an eye patch, but it did nothing to slow his effectiveness as a lawman willing to go after the worst owl hoots in the territory. He'd never backshoot a man merely to gain advantage over him, nor did he treat his prisoners with undue harshness. But by the same token, neither did he hesitate to blast someone who made the mistake of trying to put up a fight. And his treatment of anyone he took into custody was humane only to the extent the individual's behavior warranted. I won't say you've completely convinced me, but it's hard to argue against the logic of your experience, Consuela told him. What there can be no argument with, however, is that your remarks reminded me of something I would have felt very guilty over had I left it unaddressed. If I send a piece of pie with you for later, you see, then I surely should include one for your friend, Signor Crispin. And, since Fred will be there with Signor Crispin until you return, I really can't send pie anywhere near his vicinity without making sure there's some available for him, too. I don't know that you have to go to all that trouble, said Bob. Fred was going to see to it that Crispin, the prisoners, and himself got a good supper by having it fetched from the Shirley House kitchen. May not be as good as your cooking, but they put on a decent spread. I know they do, agreed Consuela, but I'm not thinking about Fred going hungry as much as I am hurting his feelings. Not that I don't fight going to gut myself, Morrison admitted, but haven't gotten a good look at your deputy, Fred. Yeah, he's a good-sized boy. Don't appear he's missed too many bites of pie or anything else that's passed his way for a while. And as far as Crispin goes, he may be scrawny as a tumbleweed twig, but he can pack away chow with the best of them. So I feel safe in speaking for him and assuring you he'd also be real grateful for a piece of that pie. Consuela rose to her feet. It's a good thing I made a second one. I'll go slice and prepare some pieces to take with you. Buford watched her leave the table and then his gaze returned to Bob. Like I said, there's a heap of good fortune for just one man. You say that like I haven't scraped against some rough edges in my time as well, Bob reminded him. What's more, you half make it sound like I got such a dose of good fortune all in one swoop. And I ain't saying Swayla's not a fine prize, mind you, that I should start figuring on nothing but torment and misery the rest of the way forward. No, I never said no such thing. Sure never meant it that way, anyhow, Buford protested. And I'll even go so far as to say that if anybody rates calling the lovely Consuela his missus, and it can't be me, well, I reckon you ain't all that undeserving. How's that? Bob cocked a single eyebrow. But I think there might have been something close to a compliment in there. How about you, lad? Buford asked, turning his attention to Bucky. How do you like having Consuela for your new mom? The red-haired youngster appeared to consider the question very earnestly before answering. Well, so far, it's not really anything too different. I mean,
Consuela had been cooking and cleaning for us and taking care of me for almost as long as I can remember. But True Ma's been dead for nearly 3 years now. And even before she passed, she was sick and weak most all the time. Consuela was there taking care of her, too. Doggone it, that was a blunt, stupid thing for me to bring up, said Buford, looking suddenly uncomfortable. I'm sorry for that, lad. Truly I am. You don't need to be. It was a fair question, Bucky said. I think about my ma a lot, and I loved her a whole bunch. I hope it didn't sound like anything less. I was just trying to say that Consuela's always been right there, too, almost like a second mom all along. So when her and Pa finally decided to get married, after folks around town kept wondering why it took so long on account of how it was so plain the way they felt about each other, well, it really didn't make that much of a change for me. Calling Consuela Mama is the only thing I'm having a little trouble getting used to. It'll come in time, Bob said. And if it doesn't, Consuela has already told you that she understands if you don't feel comfortable calling her mother. I want to, insisted Bucky. Like I said, I feel about her almost the same way and everything. It's just that... Let it go. Bob's tone was sterner this time. That's for you and Suela to work out between the two of you. And you got plenty of time. Nobody said anything for a minute. Until, with his mouth curving into an impish grin, Bucky added, I'll tell you the hardest thing for me to get used to, Mr. Marshal Morrison. And that's seeing Pa and Consuela making cow eyes at each other and sneaking smooches once in a while when they think I'm not looking. Buford emitted a hearty chuckle. Bob felt his ears burn a little and knew they'd be turning as bright a red as his thick head of hair, its shade matched perfectly by Bucky's. Still, he couldn't quite hold back a grin of his own. I'll tell you something that might be even harder for you to get used to, Buster, and that's going without the piece of pie Consuela won't be saving for you if I tell her you were being a smarty pants in front of our guest. Oh, I was only funning, little Pa. You even grinned some yourself. And you and Consuela do smooch and cuddle an awful lot since the wedding. Bob tried to glare at him, but he couldn't muster much heat. The boy was right. What was more, Bob decided, there wasn't a darn thing to be embarrassed about for cuddling and smooching his new wife. Chapter 2. A short time later, Bob and Buford quit the Hatfield house and started down the slope toward town in the marshal's office. It was a clear night. Early spring, still with a bite of leftover winter in the air. As they walked, the two men made quite an imposing pair. Bob was a couple inches short of Buford's 6'4", and not as thick through the torso, but nevertheless plenty solid and every bit as wide across the shoulders. Both men wore Colts on their right hips, displayed prominently in holsters attached to fully loaded cartridge belts. In addition, Buford carried a Winchester 73 rifle chambered for 45 caliber rounds, same as his sidearm. He strode along, carefully balancing a plate of neatly wrapped pie slices in his left hand, and the Winchester gripped casually in his right. You're never very far from that Winchester. Not even in town, are you? Bob observed. Nope, Buford answered. It gives me added range and added punch, and I decided those are benefits I kind of like, no matter where I'm at. Plus, having it openly displayed tends to discourage certain proddies who might otherwise be inclined to try and start some trouble with me. He paused a moment before adding, And then, probably above all, there's the fact that I ain't exactly grease lightning when it comes to yanking out my hog leg and putting it to use. The rifle solves that problem, too. From all reports, it seems to have solved it pretty good. You've cut a wide swath all through the territory with that rifle and that badge, and you're still going strong. Buford grunted. Trust me,
I keep at this only because no better opportunity has come along. If I could ever quit law dogging altogether, or maybe at least settle down to a sweet setup like you've got here, I'd jump on it in a heartbeat. How come you never? I just told you, lack of the right opportunity. Leastways, none that seemed right at the time. Buford cut Bob a sidelong glance. Did you ever know I considered taking on the marshal's job here at one point? Bob shook his head. No, I never heard that. Well, it did. But it was before the gold boom. Buford smiled wistfully. Things were so quiet around here back then that I feared I might die of boredom and drive like an old buffalo skull. So I passed. And then the gold strike came along only a few months later. Bob eyed him. I hope you ain't looking to edge me out of a job and take over in my place now, are you? Are you kidding? As rowdy and troublesome as this place is turning into, I'd want to ease back a notch and take it easy, not plunge into steadier action than I already got. I think I might be detecting a pattern. The right opportunity hasn't come along because of you being a mite too particular. A possibility, I reckon. But don't get too cocksure. If I could figure out a way to get rid of you and be left with the responsibility of consoling Consuela, now there would be an opportunity I'd be willing to put a powerful lot of effort into. Good thing we're having this conversation, Bob said dryly. I'm going to have to start paying closer attention to which way you swing that Winchester when we head up into the high country on the trail of those Silases tomorrow. They'd reached the flat area at the bottom of the slope, a spot the locals had taken to call in the point. Angling to the southwest from there, Front Street ran through the heart of the original community, nowadays called Old Town. This was where the town's longer-established businesses were clustered, along with residences lining a handful of side streets. Branching to the northwest from the point was what had been dubbed Gold Avenue, the main artery of Newtown. The newer businesses that had sprung up to serve the flood of gold seekers pouring in were strung out there. Predominantly tents of all shapes and sizes, mixed with a few of hastily slapped together wooden structures. At this time of evening, the stores along Front Street were closed, with the exception of Bullock's Saloon and the Shirley House Hotel. Lanterns hanging on poles issued pools of light at regular intervals, and the windows of the houses on the side streets glowed with illumination. In the other direction, up Gold Avenue, it was a different story. For the tent saloons, gambling joints, eateries, and whore cribs, this was the peak time for doing a noisy level of business. The jail building, where Bob and Buford were headed, was at the far end of quiet Front Street. For Bob, lingering for a while in this part of town was only a temporary reprieve. After he'd escorted Buford to the jail and got him settled there, the marshal would be relieving Deputy Fred of his duties for the night and would then be taking the standard evening turn around the rest of the town, boisterous Gold Avenue very much included. Bob's two other deputies, Peter and Vern Macy, were on leave for a few days, visiting and taking supplies to their younger brother Lee and Uncle Curtis up in the Prophecies, where Curtis had a long-standing, low-yielding dig, but with the promise of a big payout any time now, he kept insisting, that Lee was working with him. As Bob and Buford passed in front of Bullock's Saloon, the strains of an accordion playing what sounded like a lilting Irish ballad drifted out to them. The Irish part certainly fit, given the proud heritage of saloon owner Mike Bullock. But accordion music was something new for the establishment. Bob took note of this, more a point of interest rather than concern, and reckoned he might poke his head in at the start of his rounds to get a closer look and listen. Two blocks down from Bullock's, having also passed the Shirley House Hotel, the street took on deeper cuts of shadow between the pole lamps. The sturdy log jail building up ahead showed only a few thin slivers of light through its shuttered windows.
The accordion tune was still playing faintly inside Bob's head when it was suddenly interrupted by a harsh voice speaking from out of the shadows off to one side.
That's far enough, law dogs. Hold up right there.
Bob and Buford stopped walking. Bob's right hand automatically drifted down to hover claw-like over the .44 on his hip. Buford's Winchester remained pointing down alongside his right leg, muzzle lifted slightly, the grip of his big paw tightening. Half a block ahead, two men reverse-melted out of the shadows on either side and edged to the middle of the street in slow, cautious steps. Both wore long, rust-colored dusters, unbuttoned and flared wide open to reveal the guns buckled about their waists. The one on the left packed a converted Navy Colt in a cross-draw holster. His companion exhibited no holsters at all, but had two pearl-handled revolvers thrust behind a fully loaded cartridge belt.
"Buford Morrison, you one-eyed human hound dog," spoke the same harsh voice coming from the one flashing the Navy Colt. "Do you have any idea who it is you're standing face to face with?"
"Well," Buford drawled in a flat, emotionless tone, "given the poor lighting and my afflicted eyesight, which you so disrespectfully just made reference to, the best I might could do was hazard a guess. But by the way you're paired up, and a rotten stink floating off you, that helps me do some closer calculating. Now I make you for Omer and Abner Silas. Enjoy your successful calculating," said a new voice, just as guttural and unpleasant, coming from the one packing two pistols, "because the clock on your time for enjoying anything is about run out. Here I was hoping you fellas had come down out of the prophecy to save me a trip up to fetch you," said Buford, faking genuine disappointment. "You saying that ain't why you're here?" Now it went back to Omer, the one with the Navy Colt, for an answer.
"Not hardly, you smart mouth old bastard. What we're here for is to end your days of fetching back hapless souls to face a hangman's noose for things that should have been long ago forgot. We heard you was in the area and was going to be coming after us next, so we decided to come after you instead. What's more, we freed those other three prisoners you've been hauling across the country like freaks in a cage, and they're the same mind as us when it comes to putting a stop to your ways."
"What of the men who were guarding those prisoners?" Bob demanded. "What did you do with them?"
"Huh, wouldn't you like to know?"
taunted Abner, cocking back his head and thrusting out the swell of his belly with his two pistols on proud display. "Have you harmed those men?" Bob said through clenched teeth. "You won't make it to a hangman's noose."
"See," said Omer, "if we was the kind of low skunks old One Eye and others have falsely painted us to be, bringing bad harm to those deputies is exactly what we would have done. But we didn't. We saw them as a couple of poor slobs hired out for work that didn't have nothing personal against us. So all we did was chunk them in the head and lock them out of the way in your own jail cells."
"You might have got the same treatment, since our main purpose here was to square things with old One Eye and get him off our backsides," said Abner. "But now your snotty attitude and threats has earned you the same treatment as him."
"I wouldn't have it any other way," rasped Bob. "All I want to know is if you figure to talk us to death, or are you going to pull those hog legs and try to do something with them?" The nearly empty street suddenly became crowded with tension.
"What about the other three?" Buford prodded. "They shy about joining the party, or they just too chicken shit to show themselves?"
"They'll join in when it's time," Omer assured him. "And when they do, you'll wish they had stayed too shy."
Out of the corner of his mouth, too low for the Silases to hear, Buford said to Bob, "You think they're bluffing about the other three?"
"No, they're just stacking the deck in their favor," replied Bob. I think I saw a flicker of movement on your side to the right, in the mouth of that alley. I expect there's another one on my side. The third one I'd figure to be somewhere up high, a roof or second floor window. Yeah, I reckon that's how I'd do it. If I was a pack of ambushing polecats like them, that is. You take the alley on your side, then swing that Winchester and find the one up high. I'll clear the middle and then go after the one on my side. Wait a minute. Are you sure you can? I can do what I say. Trust me.
Hey, knock off the mumbling, you two,
barked Omer.
You got any talking to do, you talk to us.
The only thing we got left to say to you, we'll be obliged to say with lead, Buford told him. You ready to set it in motion, you gutless bag of wind? Everything froze for a long, tension-heavy moment. Bob could hear the accordion music from inside Bullock's playing ever so faintly. And then, the evening seemed to explode all at once. Homer and Abner grabbed for their guns. Quick as an eye blink, Bob had his .44 drawn and was fanning four shots so rapidly it sounded like one elongated roar. The brothers each took two rounds, dust and blood spurting from their shirt fronts as they were slammed backwards, chins dropping, mouths falling agape. They tipped inward against one another, then dropped to their knees for a second before toppling back and down. Homer had managed to clear leather with his Navy Colt, but got no further. It slipped unfired from his dead fingers as he hit the ground. Abner's gun stayed jammed behind their cartridge belt. He died with his hands closed on their grips, never having the chance to pull them free. While the Silases were dropping to the dirt, Buford was levering and firing his Winchester with practiced precision, raking the alley mouth on the right side of the street. He inadvertently chewed some wood off the corner of a building, but the rounds immediately following that found what he was seeking. First came a yelp of pain and then Slick Stansberry, one of the three prisoners Buford had hauled into town behind the bars of the tumbleweed wagon, staggered into sight, clutching his stomach and chest. A revolver he'd been grasping in one hand dropped to the ground as Slick tried to put that hand to better use, squeezing shut the bullet holes in him. But it wasn't enough. Not anywhere close. He pitched forward and was dead before he landed face down in the dust. Buford shifted his position slightly, dropping into a bit of a crouch as both his one good eye and his Winchester muzzle tilted upward, sweeping across surrounding rooftops and second-story windows. To the left of Buford, Bob shifted too. With the Silases down, he turned his attention to his side of the street, the shadowy doorways and the darkened alley. He only had two rounds left. He couldn't afford to pour random shots like Buford had done. He'd have to wait for a surer target. And then he got one. Almost too late. The tip of a rifle barrel poked out of the alley, visible for barely a second before it was spitting red flame and lead. The wind rip of a bullet passed close enough to scorch the fine hairs in Bob's right ear. But then he was returning fire, emptying the last two cartridges in his cylinder, aiming tight into the blackness around the rifle tip as flame licked out once again. The alley shooter's second round went way wide this time, whining off to slam harmlessly into a building across the street. But at least one of Bob's shots scored truer. First, the rifle fell clattering to the ground. Then came the sound of a body dropping heavily. A second later, one foot and part of a man's leg became visible, thrusting out of the alley's darkness at ground level. Three or four violent tremors passed through the foot. These turned into a pair of weak kicks, barely enough to stir a tendril of dust. Then the leg and foot became very still. Four down, one to go. As he broke open his .44 and started to reload, Bob turned back to Buford. The federal man was still sweeping his eye and his Winchester muzzle high, looking for the fifth ambusher. Bob's gaze lifted as well.
It was only the warning cock of the fifth shooter's gun that saved one or both of the lawmen from taking a serious hit. The fifth man was not at a higher level at all. In fact, he was hunkered down about as low as he could get, down in behind a watering trough just short of the alley where Stansberry had bit the dust. Thinking the errant gazes of both Bob and Buford gave him the opening he needed, this fifth gunman, one Marvin Porch by name, popped up behind the far end of the watering trough and extended a Colt 45 at arm's length. He aimed at Buford first and even succeeded in planting a pill in the old bull with his shot. Trouble was, the hammercock required to make that shot resulted in it being the only one he got off. A fraction of a second later, slugs from both Bob's 44 and Buford's Winchester were hammering mercilessly into Porch. He jerked upright, spun in a full circle under the pounding of the bullets, and then fell forward into the trough. Everything went quiet almost as quick as it had erupted. For several clock ticks, the only sound was the water slopping back and forth in the trough, where Marvin Porch's body now floated face down. Slowly, the trample of feet and the excited murmur of voices began pouring out of Bullock's and the Shirley house. Chapter 3. They waylaid me as I was coming back with our meals. Supper for the prisoners and for me and Crispin, Deputy Fred was explaining. When they shoved me through the jail door under gunpoint, I saw the three prisoners were already released from behind bars and had the drop on Crispin. Those blasted Silases tricked me by calling out like it was Fred returning, joined in Crispin. When I opened the door to them, they swarmed in and knocked me to the floor. I was too hobbled up, too slow to stop them. Next thing I knew, they was turning loose those other prisoners once they'd agreed to pitch in and help. Damn me and this gap that makes me so close to useless. You should have left me behind like everybody told you, Buford. Crispin was a lean, balding man in his middle 40s. Straightened up, he probably topped 6 feet by a half inch or so. But trying to stand or move around with the gout currently coursing so painfully through his feet and legs caused him to hunch over and drag along in a way that made him seem considerably shorter and smaller. Knock that shit off, Buford admonished him. You got fooled by a couple scalawags who've turned the tables on many a good man before you. Gout having nothing to do with it. I brung you along with me on this outing because you were the man I wanted. The man I wanted siding me over any of the others who were available. I knew I could count on you, even getting around poorly more than them. You being hobbled I can tolerate. Whining and carrying on about it, I won't. Any way you cut it, we both got snookered real good, added Fred, also hanging his head. After they had us both under their guns, they roughed us up a little, then shoved us in a cell, cuffed and gagged so we couldn't call out no warning. The main thing to remember, responded Bob, is that it turned out okay. You two don't have a patent on getting fooled by owl hoots. Hell, me and Buford did some wrong figuring of our own. If we hadn't, he wouldn't have ended up with that bullet hole in his side. That's for damn sure, muttered Buford. Stinking little worm like Marvin Porch. I should have known better than to expect a worm like him would seek out a high position to do his shooting from. Regardless of where he fired from, said tall, lanky Doc Tibbs as he was bending over to put the finishing touches on the wide bandage he was applying to Buford's side, just above his belt line. You're lucky his bullet didn't hit an inch or so more toward your middle. Number one, it likely wouldn't have passed clean through the way it did. And number two, that means it probably would have done some tumbling and tearing up of a few important internal organs. You make that sound plumb distasteful, Doc, Buford allowed. But on the other hand, the way you was poking and prodding around in that bullet hole a few minutes ago wasn't doing much to make me feel exactly lucky either. Luck is a relative thing, Marshal, said the doctor, smiling as he tied off the last tail of his bandage. A man who falls off the side of a mountain and breaks his leg
is far luckier than a man who falls off the side of that same mountain and breaks his neck. Wouldn't you say? This combination discussion medical treatment was taking place in the marshal's office of the jail building, just down the street from where the recent shootout had occurred. Also present were Mike Bullock of Bullock Saloon and Frank Drager, who ran the Shirley House Hotel with his wife Frida. Several customers from each of those establishments were milling in the street directly out front of the jail, and others were strung out up as far as to where the bodies of the victims were being gathered and loaded onto a wagon by town undertaker Titus O'Malley and his assistant. The murmur of voices coming out of the gathering was like the amplified drone of mosquitoes on a hot summer night. In no mood for a discussion on the philosophy of luck with the good doctor, Beeford said, "All I want to know is, will this patch-up job of yours be good enough so I can ride out of here tomorrow like a planned?" "How far do you intend to go?" Tibbs asked. "Cheyenne. I've got to report in, fill out the blasted paperwork on those fugitives." Buford paused, made a sour face. "Come to think on it, I guess I won't be riding out hardy like a planned at all. Our load will be considerably lighter than we figured on. Eh, Crispin?" "For a fact. But we still need to take back the wagon and the team." Buford sighed. "Yeah, and there'll still be the blasted paperwork." Buford's eyes searched out Bob. "Be a big help if I can take along a sworn and signed account from you on how things went down here tonight." "Be happy to. I'll have to write up one of my own anyway," Bob told him. "Might be in the morning before I can get it done, though. I've still got to take a turn around the town after we break up here." "I can take care of that for you, boss," spoke up Fred. "You already put in a full day. Plus, you got knocked around pretty good by those varmints," Bob reminded him. "Best you call it a night and just go ahead and..." "I'm fine, other than my bruised pride," Fred protested. "I'm all revved up and not fit for sleeping nohow. Might as well walk it off and do some good in the process." Fred was a large, heavy-set man just short of 30. The extra padding around his middle and his generally mild manner caused some folks to mistake him for being soft all over. They overlooked the spread of his shoulders, his thick wrists, and blunt-fingered, powerful hands. In his years as a deputy and now chief deputy under Bob, Fred had come a long way from the pudgy, insecure person he'd been when he first pinned on a badge, and a seldom seen, though fierce when it did rear its head, stubborn streak was part of the package. "Okay, if you sure you feel up to it," Bob conceded. "I'll be fine," Fred assured him. Partway out the door, the big deputy paused and looked back. "I see O'Malley, the undertaker, is about done loading up the bodies out here. You made up your mind yet what you're going to want to do with them?" "He'll likely ask me. You figure to bury them here, or is Marshal Morrison going to take them back with him?" "Oh, no, we ain't going to have to haul a bunch of stinking corpses all the way back to Cheyenne, are we?" groaned Crispin. Buford made a face. "Sure as hell ain't a notion that sits any more favorably with me than you," he said. He looked thoughtful for a minute. Then, "Far as I can recollect, ain't none of them got kin anywhere around close who'd take any interest in claiming the bodies. Bob, you willing to plant them here on your boot hill? Sell their horses and gear, put whatever you get toward the burial expense, and then bill the balance to the U.S. Marshal's office in Cheyenne. I'll see to it you get squared up with pronto. And if any family members should happen to come round wanting any of the varmints, they can come here and dig 'em up. How about that?" "Sounds okay to me." Bob cut his gaze to Mike Bullock. "Mike, you're on the town council. Any objection?" Bullock spread his hands. "If we can't trust the U.S. Marshal's office, who can we? By all means, go ahead and do it that way." Bob nodded. "You heard the man, Fred. Give the word to O'Malley, okay?" Once Fred had gone out the door, Doc Tibbs said to Buford, "As far as your question about riding to Cheyenne with this wound, that's mainly up to you. If you can stand the discomfort,
He can, Crispin vouched.
Then by all means, go ahead, the doctor finished. I'd ask that you stop and see me in the morning before you head out, so I can change the dressing and make sure the bleeding is still clotted good. And then I'd recommend checking in with another doctor as soon as you get to Cheyenne.
Reckon I can handle that, Buford said, knowing full well that he probably would check with the doctor in Cheyenne, only if the bullet hole was bothering him more than he expected it would be. Since this was hardly the first time he'd been shot, he had a pretty good sense of how serious this latest encounter with a chunk of lead was, and he didn't rate it as all that bad. A handful of minutes later, once the doctor had packed up his bag and taken his leave, and Bob had gone out into the street to clear away the lingering gawkers, things turned quiet and peaceful in the jail office. Bullock and Drager had also left, and Crispin, after gobbling a handful of pain pills the doctor gave him for his gout, had gone back to an empty cot in the lockup to sleep. Bob sat behind his desk. Buford was in a chair hitched up before it. They were passing back and forth a bottle of good bourbon that Bob had produced from a desk drawer.
Mighty smooth stuff you're serving up here, barkeep, Buford said as he handed the bottle back after taking a touch.
Glad you find it to your taste, Bob responded. Afraid I'm not a very discerning judge because, to tell you the truth, I don't do a lot of drinking. Still, there are times.
Like tonight.
Uh-huh. 5 men dead under our guns, Buford mused. They weren't much, but still, they were men. Taking a human life ought not ever come easy. But I gotta admit, the longer I'm in this business, the less I find it bothering me. Especially when it comes to ambushing skunks like the Silases. In fact, and I know this is gonna make me sound almighty cold, for the way things turned out tonight, I'm feeling more sadness for those pieces of pie that got smashed in the street than I do for the men we cut down. Bob cocked an eyebrow. Yeah, I have to allow as to how that does sound a mite cold. His expression stayed blank for a minute. Then it was split by a lopsided grin. On the other hand, that was some tasty pie. Buford held out his hand and Bob handed the bottle back. After he'd taken a long pull and then unbent his elbow again, Buford said,
comes to mind something else I want to comment on.
Such as? Buford gestured.
You. Your speed with that .44 you pack.
Make for a problem?
Not really. Although the Silases might have a different opinion if they was around to spout it. The thing is, I've seen fast draws before, and God knows I've heard enough gut wind from those who've claimed to be fast, but I've never stood alongside anybody with lightning in their hand the way you've got.
Buford wagged his head.
All the times I've passed through here since you took on the marshal's job, I guess I only vaguely picked up the notion you was pretty good with a shooting iron. Sundown Bob, I've heard some call you. But I also heard how you don't like being referred to that way, so I didn't spend much time reflecting on it. Can't help wondering now, though, if that came from you setting the sun for a few hombres with that lightning draw of yours.
Bob grinned tolerantly. That'd make a better story, I reckon. Leastways for some. Truth of it ain't nothing like that, though. It came from a flaming red hair. Red as a sundown, somebody once said, and damned if it didn't stick. Not particularly to my liking, as you already know.
Morrison grunted. You're right. My version makes a better story. Bottom line, as far as I'm concerned, remains that I somehow never got the full impression of how good and how fast you really are. Sort of caught me by surprise when I saw it on display out there a little while ago.
Bob shrugged. It's a thing that comes in handy when called for. That's all. Don't mean it's something I advertise or make a big deal of. We both know what too often follows when word spreads about somebody being quick on the draw.
That kind of attention I neither want nor need.
Nobody does, Buford said. Trouble is, not too many who've got the gift, if you want to call it that, are smart enough to play it that way.
Makes you a rare bird, Bob. One I'm honored to know and call a friend.
I appreciate that and feel likewise about you.
Bob grinned. Hell, I'd even drink to it if you ever hand that bottle back.
Chapter 4. Bloody ambush in the streets of Rattlesnake Wells. 5 desperadoes fatally rebuked by brave lawmen. So read the front page headline in the Weld Gazette when it hit the street 2 days following the shootout with the Silage brothers and their freed prisoner accomplices. A newspaper in Rattlesnake Wells was still a relatively new thing. It had started up right after the first of the year, the timing happening to coincide with the marriage of Bob and Consuela. In fact, the first issue of the Gazette had carried, also on its front page, a full article on the wedding. The coverage was more than warranted by the popularity of the couple, not to mention the fact that the event proved to be a town-wide shindig rivaling the recent New Year's Eve celebration. Bob himself could have done without all the fuss and attention, but seeing the happy glow that emanated from his bride and feeling the swell of affection and pride that filled him to near bursting, even he had to admit, in the end, that it was a grand time well worth recording for posterity. In the weeks and months that followed, getting used to being married came a whole lot easier for Bob than getting used to the Gazette. Or more to the point, its publisher, editor, star reporter, Owen Dutton. As Bucky had explained to Buford Morrison, having Consuela now transitioned into Mrs. Hatfield didn't really bring about that many changes to their household, since she had, in essence, already been part of the family for so long anyway. It had taken her abduction by the vile Shaw clan the prior fall, and the prospect of possibly losing her forever, to jolt Bob into finally fully realizing, and admitting to himself, his deep feelings for her. Something that had been apparent to others around town all along. Once he and a select posse of men had succeeded in rescuing Consuela and another hostage from the Shaws, it hadn't taken Bob long to confess his feelings and ask for her hand. Having never made a secret of the feeling she in turn had long harbored for Bob, the answer was an immediate yes. Initial plans to hold out for a spring wedding had quickly eroded, resulting in a ceremony just after the first of the year. No plans for a honeymoon were made, at least not any time in the foreseeable future. That part was taken care of in the privacy of Bob and Consuela's now shared bedroom, the biggest, not to mention easiest and most pleasant, change to their prior arrangement. So while these adjustments were occurring on the home front, the adjustment to having a local newspaper was happening throughout the town. For the most part, it was a welcome thing. After all, a community claiming its own newspaper was a good sign, a sign of healthy growth and significance, like the spur rail line that had been put in, and other positive changes that had come with the gold boom, as opposed to the less positive things associated with Gold Avenue and the flow of lowlifes and schemers it unfortunately attracted, along with those seeking only a chance to work hard in order to try and catch a lucky break. It was Owen Dutton's personality more than anything, his over-eager determination to find a story, no matter how obnoxious he had to be in order to dredge one up, that tended to rub some folks the wrong way. Chief among them, Marshal Hatfield. As far as the lead story in this latest edition of the Gazette, it was straightforward and accurate enough, albeit embellished with a good deal of sensationalized touches, like the headline itself. That's mainly what it came down to with Dutton and his articles. He always got his facts right. He just couldn't keep from pushing too hard to find the most sensational angle, even in the simplest story. He did this both with his interviewing technique and then with the manner in which he wrote it down.
A classic example of this, Bob recalled with a wry grin as he scanned the current copy Deputy Fred had shoved under his nose, was the interview Dutton had tried to conduct with Buford Morrison on the morning the federal man was getting ready to leave. Dutton had been out of town, chasing what turned out to be an empty lead, on some alleged cattle rustling activity the evening of the Silas shootout, so hadn't had the chance to start catching up with all the details until the following morning. His timing, as a result, caught Buford sore and cranky from his bullet wound, from also being a tad bit hungover and anxious to be on his way for Cheyenne. It had taken only a few minutes of Dutton's persistent, rapid-fire inquiry before Buford lost his patience with questions like, "How did you assess the danger factor in your opponents in order to select the best sequence for you to cut them down?" Or, "Why did you shoot to kill in every instance, rather than merely disarm?" "I tell you what," Buford had interrupted with a growl, "how about I throw your ass in the back of my tumbleweed wagon? It's all cleaned out, nice and fresh and empty, and you can ask questions all the way to Cheyenne. We'll keep a tally. If you ask some good ones, by the time we get there, you'll have a hell of a story. Not just about this here shootout, but plenty of others that are sure to come up, too. Enough for a whole book. But if you keep asking dumbass questions like the ones you've been spouting so far, then when we get to Cheyenne, I'll turn you over to the judge and recommend charges against you for impersonating an actual journalist. You willing to take the gamble?" Not surprisingly, Dutton had turned down the offer. So Buford went on his way and Dutton found other sources, primarily Bob, to put together his story. As he finished reading it now, the marshal saw that it was the usual factual account, dressed up with plenty of gory details and dramatic phrasing. Not for the first time, Bob mused that wherever Dutton had done his journalism training, he clearly found time, in addition to his scholarly reading, to devour more than a few of the action-packed dime novels of the day that were so popular throughout the country. The influence was unmistakable in his writing. "Well, what do you think?" Fred asked when Bob lowered the paper. "Same thing I always think," Bob answered. "In among the overwrought passages and between all the exclamation points, Dutton gets his names and facts straight." "Oh, I think you're sometimes too hard on the man, boss. I know it can be an annoying little pipsqueak from time to time, but he don't really mean no harm." "Yeah, he comes on a little strong, always trying to pump more excitement into a thing than is truly there, but overall he ain't so bad. Plus he does a lot of what you call human interest pieces that folks enjoy. Recipes and new babies and reports of family gatherings around town, stuff like that." Bob jammed a thumb toward the battered old coffee pot over on the stove. "The day he prints a recipe we can follow to get a decent cup of coffee out of that thing, I will take back every uncharitable word or thought I ever had about old Owen. Is that fair enough?" "No, it ain't fair at all. That would be bordering on the impossible, maybe even talking about tampering with the spirit world," Fred said stubbornly. He slapped the headlined article on the paper he was now holding. "There's nothing here that you've got any business finding fault with. He made the band hombres look bad and us fellas fighting on the right side look good. He even downplayed the way me and Crispin got hornswoggled and ended up locked out of the fight. And you and Buford, look there, right smack in the headline, rebuked by brave lawmen. That ain't nothing to grouse about if you ask me." "Okay. Okay," Bob said with a weary sigh. "It's a splendid piece of journalism and deserves to be on display in a museum somewhere. Is that better? Now can we move on to other things? After all, that shooting was 2 days ago, and it's been awful quiet around here ever since. Not that I'm complaining exactly, but I start to get a little itchy when things are too doggone calm." "Be careful what you wish for, boss," Fred cautioned earnestly. "We're coming off a pretty hard winter, not too far into spring, but summer's just around the corner, and you know how things tend to bust open more when the weather gets hot."
Yeah, I guess I should appreciate the calm while it lasts. Then, stealing a line from Buford Morrison, Bob added, I just don't want to die of boredom and dry up like an old buffalo skull.
Huh?
Never mind. Just something I heard somewhere. Well, I wouldn't worry too much about the calm or the boredom. Take a closer look at a couple more things right here. Fred waved the newspaper again. I can spot trouble brewing that I got a pretty good hunch we're bound to get involved in sooner or later. You mean that piece about the cattle rustling that's supposedly going on west of town? The rustling that Dutton got a big lead on and went out to see for himself the other night? The trouble was, he came back without ever catching sight of anything, not even a scrawny coyote. Yet it still didn't stop him from running his article just to help keep things stirred up, didn't it? You see, that's the side of him I find so damned annoying. Maybe so. But you know who's behind those rustling claims, don't you? I know who, and I've got a pretty good idea why. Bob frowned. The who is Ed Wardell. The why is because he's had a burr under his saddle ever since last summer, when Carlos Vandez bought those sections of land off the Widow Terlane and expanded his V-slash spread so it borders Wardell's Rockin' W property for a good long stretch. Near to 5 miles, Fred said. Wardell hates Mexicans. Can't say I've ever heard exactly why, but it's a fact he's made plenty clear on more than one occasion. So now, all of a sudden, he not only has a Mexican for a neighbor, but the Mexican spread has expanded bigger and, by all accounts, is more successful than the Rockin' W. This leaves Wardell in a seething rage pretty much around the clock. The only way his pride will let him face the fact that a greaser could pull off something like that is to start believing something underhanded must be going on. Underhanded like rustling? That'd fit the bill. Fred's face scrunched up. You mean you think Wardell is making it all up? I got no proof of that. I'm just sort of thinking out loud. But neither does Wardell have any hard proof to back up his rustling claims. That's part of the problem. Even if it was within our jurisdiction, he can't offer a trail or a sighting or an altered brand. Nothing that makes a starting point to go after any culprits. All he does is keep claiming he's got missing cattle. Like you said a minute ago, we're coming off a hard winter. Maybe he lost an undue number of head into the weather, or maybe some have wandered off and his brush poppers haven't rounded him up yet. So it could be that Wardell is jumping the gun with his rustling claims. And because he hates Mexicans so much, he thinks, and he's hitting hard for others to think, that Carlos Vandez might be behind it. Bob shrugged. Remember, I'm just thinking out loud. Nobody hates cattle thieves worse than I do, even if it's outside our jurisdiction. If I truly thought a mangy pack of long loopers was at work anywhere in our area, I'd probably still offer our services to try and run them down. But I ain't sold on the idea. Remember, too, neither has Wardell been able to convince the U.S. Marshals to send anybody to look into it. Yeah, he's made plenty of noise about that, too. And when he heard Buford Morrison pass through the other day without even a glance in his direction, it set him off all over again. Fred paused, his expression darkening with a deepened concern. In fact, that's actually what I meant when I said I could spot trouble brewing in this newspaper article about the wrestling. It reminded me of what else Wardell said about the law refusing to get involved. And what was that? Bob wanted to know. He said he was sending for some special men to hire on to his ranch crew. Hard case wranglers who knew how to work cattle and also how to deal with trouble in cases where men had to make their own justice. Bob scowled. You sure he said that? I didn't hear it with my own ears, but I sure heard about it secondhand from plenty of folks. There was still some talk about it in the Bluebird Cafe this morning when I stopped for breakfast. Well, that's just great. Why didn't I hear about it before this? I figured you had. I guess that's why I didn't say anything. It was just a couple days ago. Like I said, after Marshal Morrison left without making a swing out to the Rockin' W.
Now I suppose I'm gonna have to, Bob said with a sour look. First to see if Wardell went ahead and did send for some hard cases. Second to see if I can get him to ease up and call him off. That's all we need is for hombres like that to show up and set a damn range war in motion over something that amounts to nothing. Fred shifted his feet and looked anxious.
There's something else we haven't talked about yet that I think you're going to want to pay closer attention to also.
Something else covered in the Gazette?
Uh-huh.
Fred smoothed out the elongated single sheet of paper on Bob's desk once more, then leaned over and pointed to another small article on the back side. The header for this one read, John Larkin released from prison, reportedly on his way back to Rattlesnake.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.